discuss something. Actually, I'm a radiologist, and this is a multidisciplinary team approach. Here, I see the surgeon, oncologist. So my presentation is about, I say this is the learning breast imaging among multidisciplinary team. So our learning objective today is about the technique of mammogram, anatomy, how to read mammogram, mammographic ultrasound correlation, and lymph node characterization, breast MRI, and few points about the post-operative surveillance. To improve detection and management skill, this is our today's goal. So this is a mammographic technique. What we do here, this is a CC view, that is craniocaudal view. Here we compress the breast in superior and inferior direction. And this is a MLO view, not the true lateral view. Remember, this is MLO view. So we can take into account the superolateral quadrant of the breast. We know this is the most vulnerable quadrant and the medial compartment of the breast. So that's why we do the MLO view. So this is a picture. This is a MLO view, and this is a craniocaudal view. So before going to pathology or how to describe film, first I like to say the few anatomy of the breast MRI. This is a corpus mammary. This is a retromammary fold. This is nipple. And this is, as we know, this is a crest of duret. This is pectoralis major muscle. This pectoralis major muscle should be included in MLO view at the within the line of the nipple, within 3 centimeters within the line of the nipple, and in the CC view, this should be also included in the CC view also. How we read a mammogram? Now, this is a, I think this is a preceptorship program. So when I ask the audience, please answer some question, otherwise, I will lose my interest there, whether you can understand my lecture or not. So this is a MLO view. This is a right breast and this is a left breast. When we read a mammogram, as we have both breast mammogram, we compare the right and left side by side, not right and left. That is MLO and CC side by side. We do the MLO side by side, CC side by side. Its importance is so we can compare each other side by side. So we read the mammogram like this. First, we read the upper one third. We compare on both sides. So if you compare the upper one third on both sides, you see here the lymph node with fatty hilum. Here the lymph node thickened, large. There is no fatty hilum here. Now the middle compartment. Now we compare the middle third of the breast. If you compare the middle third, you can see there is a lesion here. Lesion here in compared to this, and in the inferior third, there is no lesion here. Next, the CC view like this. We compare upper third, middle third, and lower third. So we can see in the middle third, we can detect a lesion here. In the next, we will discuss how we characterize lesion. Now, how we can detect a lesion. Second, we see the nipple areolar complex area first, then upper third, lower third. Again, nipple areolar complex area, upper third, lower third. Next, we detect a lesion. So what is the site of the lesion? This is a diagrammatic picture of MLO view, and this is a diagrammatic picture of CC view. If we see a lesion in the, this is nipple, above the nipple line, this is upper quadrant, superior quadrant, this is lower quadrant. In CC view, if we draw a line here, if this is upper this to this line, this is outer quadrant always, this is inner quadrant. So any lesion here in the superior quadrant, that is upper quadrant, and here it is outer quadrant. So this lesion is upper outer quadrant of right breast. So our lesion is here. If we draw a line here, this is outer quadrant. If we draw a line from here, this is upper quadrant. So upper outer quadrant. So another lesion here, sometimes it is not so easy to define a control quadrant. So this is another lesion. If we draw a line from the line of nipple, we can see this is lower quadrant. Now, if we draw a line here, what do we see? The line transects the lesion. So it is outer quadrant or inner quadrant. So that sometimes it is very difficult. So I'm making it easy. If it is here in the lower quadrant, you see in the CC view here. So CC view in the midline, if you think a clock, this is 12 o'clock superiorly and 6 o'clock inferiorly. So you see here the lesion in the inferior position, lower quadrant. So this is in the 6 o'clock position. So sometimes it is not always possible to say the quadrant. Now the number of the lesion, if any lesion in any quadrant, we see single lesion in either breast in single quadrant, this also a single lesion in each breast. If it is in single quadrant, one quadrant, two or multiple lesion, we see it is a multifocal lesion. And if it is in the different quadrant lesion or more than 5 centimeter, we call multicentric lesion. So this is the multifocal, multicentric lesion. It has importance to decide the whether the patient is candidate for BCT or mastectomy. So that identify the lesion multicentric or multifocal is very important. Now go to the, we are going to next slide. Now I want your participation. So you can see here two lesion. You can see here two lesion. If we draw a line from here, you can see both of these lesion in which quadrant? Outer quadrant. If I draw a line from here, in which quadrant? Upper quadrant. So both these lesion are in upper outer quadrant. So whether it is multicentric or multifocal? Multifocal. So both these lesions are multifocal. Now we're going to next slides. So now this from single to double to now multiple lesion. Here we can see, if I draw a line from here, what we can see, two lesions in outer quadrant, one in inner quadrant. If I draw a line from here, that is two lesions in upper, one in lower. So two lesions in upper outer quadrant, single lesion in lower inner quadrant. So this is only multicentric. Multifocal and multicentric. Now, after detection of the lesion, our next goal is whether the lesion is single or multiple, in which quadrant. Now, the next decision is whether the location of the lesion, that is in anterior aspect, medial aspect, or deep to nipple. So we divide the lesion into anterior, medial, or posterior compartment. Now, you can see if a lesion in which quadrant it is, that is, what's the depth of the lesion, anterior or medial or posterior depth? Middle depth. Before going to interpretation of mammography, or if you see a reporting on mammography, you must understand what is ACR breast density. ACR breast density is very important, because I'm describing it, then you understand what is the importance of ACR breast density. This is ACR density, means American College of Radiology proposed some density of the breast according to the composition of the breast, that is fibroglandular tissue. This is a density A. It means there is less than 25% fibroglandular tissue. That is, it is predominantly a fatty breast. As we see, this is predominantly a fatty breast. In breast density B, 25 to 50% fibroglandular tissue. There is scattered areas of fibroglandular tissue. In C, there is a fibroglandular tissue 50 to 75%, and glandular tissue are heterogeneously distributed. But in density D, here you can see more than 75% of fibroglandular tissue, and it is extremely dense breast. What is its important? Its importance is, I can underline here, higher the density of the breast, the lower the sensitivity and specificity of the detection of the lesion. That is, more the density of the breast, less the chance of detection of the lesion, less the sensitivity of specificity. So any breast disease with C and B category, if they cannot detect any lesion, this does not exclude that patient does not have any lesion in the breast. Remember this. So first, in your reporting, we must mention what is the density of the breast. So there is a mammography lexicon, that is, we must follow before reporting or interpreting a mammography, we must follow their this lexicon. Lexicon means that we should talk in the same language. In lexicon, they first say that we must tell about the composition of the lesion, then the characterization of the mass. So BIRAS lexicon is designed to standardize the breast imaging reporting and to reduce confusion in breast imaging interpretations. It also facilitates outcome monitoring and quality assessment. It contains a lexicon for standardized terminology for mammography and breast ultrasound MRI. So you cannot use in your own language. You must talk in your mammography report with the lexicon language. So now I'm describing how we describe a lesion. When we see a pathology like a mass, when you say it is a mass is a space occupying 3D lesion. We must see it in two different projection, not in single direction projection. If a potential mass is seen in only single projection, it should be called a asymmetry until it's three-dimensionally confirmed. So when we see a lesion in two view, we say it is a mass. In single view, we say it is a asymmetrical breast density. It may be mass or something else. So when you get a mass, first we characterize what is the shape of the mass. After detecting the mass, our next goal is to differentiate whether it is a benign lesion or a malignant lesion. So our next description, we will differentiate after detecting a lesion, whether this is a benign or malignant lesion. So breast lexicon describes three types of shape: oval, round, and irregular. So from oval to irregular, the chance of malignancy is increases. In the next slide, we see this is a well-defined lesion, little bit lobulated, but here we can see almost a rounded lesion, and here you can see a speculated lesion. Clearly, we can see a speculated lesion. Next, the very important thing, sometimes we don't see about the shape, size, whatever it is. We see the margin of the lesion. So margin is very important. First, the circumscribed, as we know, as it is circumscribed, it is benign, but it is not always true. Obscured, microlobulated, indistinct, and speculated. As the lesion from circumscribed to speculated characteristics, the lesion going to be benign from malignant. So this is a lesion. First we see it was a oval-shaped lesion. You can see the lobulation, but it is well marginated. You can see there is an obscured. The lesion is fairly, it's actually well-defined, but these margins are obscured, not ill-defined, due to superimposition of the breast tissue. And this margin is ill-defined, but this margin, you can see here, this margin is speculated. If you see in the next slide, this margin is speculated. So this is benign or malignant? This is most likely benign lesion. This is indeterminate lesion as the margin is obscured, most likely benign. From here, the rate of malignancy increases, chance of malignancy increases. So next important thing is the density. Lower the density, it imposes that if the density is lower, the lesion contains fat. So more chance of benignity. Higher the density, the more chance of malignancy. That is, high density of cell, that is, increases the density of the lesion. And sometimes indistinct isodense lesions are there. So we thought this isodense lesion are indeterminate lesion. That is, it could be benign or malignant. So higher the density, more chance is malignancy. So here you can see, there is a lesion here. You can see the centrally hypodense area, that is black area here. So this is a benign lesion. This is an intramammary lymph node. There you can see a high density lesion. If you compare with the parenchyma here, this is a high density lesion, speculated margin. So this is a malignant lesion. And here it is very tough to see. Here you can see a lesion here. You can see the lesion here. That is isodense with the rest of the breast parenchyma. So most likely this is a benign lesion. So after characterizing the mass of the lesion, next we go the asymmetry. The as we mentioned, the asymmetry, we will see this in the single view. So asymmetry actually two types. If it is seen in one projection, it is called asymmetry, that is, it is a truly benign lesion. And there is another asymmetry, we can see it in two projection, but it not mass like, but in different form, we can see this asymmetry in two view. This asymmetry could be focal asymmetry, global asymmetry, and developing asymmetry. You must understand what we say in our reporting. Otherwise, there will be communication gap between the radiologist and the oncologist and surgeon. So asymmetry, the first asymmetry I said in one projection, this is mostly caused by superimposition of normal breast tissue. The focal asymmetry visible on two projection, this has to be differentiated from a mass. That is, it could be really a mass. Next, global asymmetry, it consisting of an asymmetry over at least one quarter of the breast, that is actually one quadrant of the breast, is usually a normal variant. And another is developing asymmetry. It is new, larger, and more conspicuous than a previous examination. If we compare with the previous film, we see a new asymmetry in some area of the breast developing. So it is called developing asymmetry. It should need our attention. Next important thing for our mammography reporting is calcification. Most of the people, they don't bother about the margin shape. They bother about the calcification. If anyone heard about that there is a micro calcification, what I said about whether there is a benign or there's some language here, I will tell you. They just heard about the micro calcification. Once their mind know that micro calcification means carcinoma, you should come out from this. Micro calcification does not always means carcinoma. That's why this is the important thing. So these are going to previous slide. In 2003, Biders categorized three types of calcification: benign, intermediate concern, and high probability. Now in 2013, we are using these two types of calcification, typically benign and suspicious morphology. The intermediate concern calcification, they put it into the suspicious morphology. So typically benign calcification are like this. Sometimes in mammogram, you can see some scattered microcalcification in whole breast. You can see at this benign scattered microcalcification. Actually, this calcification are skin calcification from the sebaceous gland. Next, milk of calcium, rod-like plasma cell mastitis, dystrophic calcification, popcorn calcification, usually found in fibroadenoma, rim calcification, vascular calcification, round calcification, and punctate calcification. What concern to that there is a communication gap happen in between the radiologist and the surgeon or oncologist, that when you mention there is a calcification, you see these are the micro calcification scatteredly distributed all of the whole breast. These are the benign calcification. This punctate calcification, this is also benign calcification. Now the suspicious morphology. When you see this amorphous calcification, but scatteredly, this is benign. But amorphous calcification like cluster, this is DCIS. Few fine pleomorphic calcification, these are suspicious for malignancy. These are the coarse heterogeneous calcification, suspicious for malignancy, fine linear, and this is fine linear, and you can see the branch of the duct. These are the suspicious for malignancy. So differentiate this malignant calcification is very important. All calcifications, not all microcalcifications are malignant. So distribution, not only the shape of the calcification. Now the distribution of the calcification is very important. If it is diffuse, that is more likely to be benign. If it is regional, more likely to be benign. If it is linear or segmental, more likely to be malignant. If it is grouped, these are the indeterminate, need attention. So this is the how we say which one diffuse. This is diffuse calcification. This is regional calcification. This is grouped, that is within a areas. This is a linear calcification. This is segmental. This is a segmentally distributed lesion. So in practically, you see what we see here. As you see, there is a fibroadenoma with a calcification. You see, there's a dystrophic calcification here. So this is a benign lesion. These are the macro calcification scatteredly distributed in whole of the breast. This is benign calcification. You can see the scatteredly distributed calcification in whole breast. This is benign calcification. So these more example, the calcification are scatteredly distributed, benign calcification. You see, don't afraid. Calcification means malignant. These are all benign calcification. This rod-like calcification, this is benign calcification. So here is the example. Here you can see the malignant and benign calcification simultaneously. This is a vascular calcification. This is benign calcification. But what you see here associated with the mass is the calcification, branching and cluster microcalcification. This should be our concern. This is another example of, you see the shape of the calcification. This is macro calcification, but still it is clustered and branching. So, and associated with an ill-defined mass. It was a malignant lesion. This is our concern. You can see the minute calcification here, micro calcification. Can you see here from the back? This is scattered micro calcification here. This is also benign calcification. This is not malignant. So this is also another example, the micro calcification scatteredly distributed. It is very hard to see here because of light. Next, after reporting this, associated feature is very important in case of mammography. That is whether there is a skin retraction, nipple retraction, skin thickening, trabecular thickening, axillary lymphadenopathy, or architectural disruption. So here we can see, we can identify an image here in the inner quadrant. What happened here, you can see the nipple here very clearly, but nipple here, it is retracted. Skin retracted, nipple retracted. So this is the additional finding. Now, after describing the lesion, detecting the lesion, our next, the what is our final assessment about the reporting? Previously, we say that it is a benign lesion, malignant lesion, or mass, only mass, SOL in the breast. There is no chance to say SOL in the breast. You must categorize a lesion. In the categorizing the lesion according to BIDADS. That is BIDADS 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So if you think that you need additional imaging or prior examination, you cannot assess from this examination. This is BIDADS 0. So this is BIDADS 1. If you see it is normal, you can say negative, and routine screening is recommended. If it is, you think it is a benign lesion, so it is BIDADS 2. That is probably it is a benign lesion, and routine screening is recommended. If we think it is a, you are not sure whether it is a benign lesion, that is probably benign lesion, we ask for short interval follow-up. That is, there is less than 2% chance of malignancy. But clinician, according to patient age and history, family history of positive, you can do the core biopsy in the same patient, BIDADS 3. In BIDADS 4, if we think it is a suspicious lesion, this is BIDADS 4, we go for tissue diagnosis. In BIDADS 5, we also highly likely to be malignancy, we go for tissue diagnosis. In BIDADS 6, that is a known biopsy proven malignancy. Now our next topic about the mammogram ultrasound correlation, which is very important. The mammogram and ultrasound correlation. Suppose a clinical scenario, a 42-year-old woman was found to have a circumscribed mass at upper outer quadrant of left breast. At diagnostic ultrasound, the mass was assessed as probably benign and its location was ultrasound 5 o'clock. That is, the lesion was at the upper outer, but ultrasound shows it is a 5 o'clock position. So which one is correct? Is mammography image correct, or ultrasound detect the wrong lesion or the same lesion? So sometimes as we write the lesion in the 5 o'clock, clinician says, no, that I see the mammogram, the lesion is the upper outer quadrant. So that is the explanation why it is occurs. So what happened in the MLO view? MLO view is not a true lateral view. It is an oblique view. It causes the breast, superaspect and infraspect in this direction, not in superolateral direction. So what happened here? You see the lateral component of the breast tissue is upwards direction, moves upward direction. So the explanation is, in MLO view, if any lesion in the lateral quadrant of breast, remember lateral quadrant of breast, far away from the nipple, it goes upwards in MLO view. If it is near, the more it's near to the nipple, the more it static in position. That is 3 o'clock ultrasound, 3 o'clock in mammogram. But more it's far away from the nipple, it is high up, that it may be in the different quadrant. So how to remember this? Remember, lateral, in the lateral quadrant. Lateral means light, it goes up. So by this we remember lateral quadrant, lateral lesion, it is light lesion, it goes up. So opposite things happen in the medial quadrant. This is medial quadrant. You see, if any lesion near to the nipple, it is more in static position, that is in the same clock position. If the more far away it is from the nipple, it is in the lower position in the MLO view. As we see, the breast compressed in this aspect. So for remember, medial means metal, it is heavy. That's why it is fall down, that is in lower quadrant. That is moves lower than the ultrasound. We must accurately, why it is important? We must accurately identify this definitive mammographic suspicious finding on ultrasound when there are two lesions, a benign and malignant lesion, for accurate biopsy site, for marker site, pre-CT marker. That's why detection of the lesion is very important. To this must correlate mammogram and ultrasound finding. So here you can see in the MLO view, this is a benign lesion, this is a malignant lesion. And they see almost same, so same size. So if we want to do the core biopsy of the lesion, we put a pre-CT marker here. So we must identify in the ultrasound which lesion is malignant, we can see in the mammography. If you don't correlate the ultrasound and mammographic image, it will be a disaster. So a lesion seen on ultrasound as well as circumscribed lesion apart the pec major muscle, on mammography, the lesion is far away from the chest wall. Is it this same lesion? That is, in mammography, it is far away from chest wall. In ultrasonography, we see the lesion within the chest wall. Like this, the lesion above the pec major. But in mammography, you see the lesion is far away from the chest wall. Why this happened? It happened because in ultrasound, we put the patient in supine position. So the breast compressed against the pec major. That's why the lesion above the pec major. But in mammography, we pull the breast tissue from the pec major. That's why the lesion is far away from pec major. So in mammography, usually we try to tell that the lesion is invade the chest wall, because sometimes it is false positive, as the breast tissue already compressed the fall on the pec major muscle. That's why ultrasonographically it is very difficult to say in a malignant lesion it invades the chest wall or not. Next question: a lesion seen on ultrasound as well as circumscribed oval lesion, on mammography the lesion is rounded in shape. So a mammography lesion, clinician sees the lesion rounded, but in ultrasound, I show this is the same lesion. Is it true? The surgeon is confused. Is this the same lesion? Yes, these are the same lesion. Because in ultrasound, again, patient in supine position, the breast compressed over the breast tissue. So sometimes the cyst may appear like this. So this shape variation may occur between the mammography and ultrasonography. Another question: a mass was measured 28 by 23 millimeter. It is commonly occurred. upper outer quadrant of right breast. In ultrasound, the same mass measured 24 by 19 millimeter. How it's happened? It's happened because in ultrasound, what we measure the core of the mass. But in mammography, we cannot see the core of the mass. What we measure in the mammography, the core of the lesion as well as the surrounding desmoplastic changes. So all these lesion and the surrounding desmoplastic changes appear dense in the mammogram. So when we measure in the mammogram, we see all the entire lesion. But in ultrasonogram, we can see the margin of the lesion sometimes clearly, the angle of the lesion. So that's why the measuring difference occurs between ultrasonogram and mammogram. So can mammography pick all lesions? So in this case, you see very quick. Can you see any lesion here? In this patient, can you detect any lesion here? This is CC, MLO, sorry. This is CC view. In mammography, actually, this is a very dense breast. So we cannot see any lesion in this patient. But when we did ultrasound, yes, we can. You can see there is a scary lesion here. This is a Byers 5 lesion is here at 10 o'clock. That is upper outer quadrant. So I again go back to the lesion. Can you see any lesion here? Yes, you can see there's some fine speculated mass here. In retrograde aspect, we detect a lesion here in the upper outer quadrant. So in mammography, in dense breast, you can miss any lesion. So this is another lesion. We can easily see there is a lymphadenopathy. So there must be lesion here, but we cannot detect any lesion in the ultrasonograph. But when we did a mammogram, you see ultrasound, we can easily see a lesion at 11 o'clock position in left breast. So again, we go back to the image. This is the 11 o'clock position. This is 12 o'clock. This is 11 o'clock. We cannot recognize any lesion here. This is the same patient. So this is a breast density C breast. We miss the lesion. But ultrasonography, by doing correct ultrasound, this patient did ultrasound outside. The ultrasound was normal, but we find the lesion. This is another case. You can see the CC and MLO view. We cannot see any lesion. This is a breast density C breast. Can you see any lesion here? Okay. See, the upper one-third compared on both sides, the middle one-third compared on the both sides, the lower one-third. Again, on this side, upper one-third, middle one-third, lower one-third. Second point, nipple areolar complex. Can you see any difference between this nipple areolar complex? Yes, there is something in the left. Okay. So if we go step-by-step approach, you can detect the shuttle lesion also. So this is a lesion here. You can see. There's a left breast retroareolar region. This is the lesion here. So this is another case. You see, if we compare upper third, middle third, lower third. Is there any asymmetry lower third? No. Middle third? No. Any asymmetry in the upper third? Here is the asymmetry. But if we see a quick look, you see it is a normal. Again, upper one third, yes, some asymmetry is there. Middle one third, normal. Lower one third, normal. So what was the finding? You can see there is a lesion here. This is the lesion here. Though it was a benign lesion, but there was a lesion here. So mammography is not so easy. It's very difficult. So this is another case. It's quite easy. There is an asymmetry if we compare on this side. So always look for asymmetry in this dense breast. It is not easy for the fatty breast. It is very easy to detect a lesion in the fatty breast. But in our country, most of the Asian women, the breast carcinoma occurs in the early ages. So most women have dense breast. So pick the lesion, that is shuttle lesion, early detection is very tough. So this is another lesion. If we see any, can you see any lesion here? Only lymph node. Some asymmetry is there. Can you see some asymmetry is there? So when you did the CC view, you see the lesion is very easily detected. So sometimes we have to depend on the two view, not the single view, both CC and MLO view. So in MLO view, sorry. In MLO view, you hardly see the lesion, but in CC view, you can easily get the lesion. This is a case, here you can see, this is a diagnosed case of breast carcinoma. You can see there is some lesion here. There is one lesion here and one lesion here, okay? This CC view, MLO view, you can easily detect one lesion here, one lesion here. After doing ultrasound, what we find? There is three lesion. One lesion, in the previously we see one lesion here and one lesion here. That is multifocal, that is in one quadrant. But after doing ultrasound, what we see here? One lesion here in the, I think it is 1 o'clock. Another lesion is 3 o'clock. And another lesion is 4 o'clock. So it becomes now multicentric, multifocal lesion. But if we interpret only in the mammogram, it was only multifocal lesion. Now it is multifocal and multicentric lesion. So this is another shuttle lesion, 7 millimeter of a doctor. The mammogram was totally normal. It was, she was done, it's mammogram, sonogram, for the screening purpose. The mammogram was normal and we did ultrasound and this shuttle lesion was found. We did biopsy and patient now improved. BCT was done. This is another patient. This patient age was only 28 years. That's why mammogram was not performed. The ultrasound was done outside. It was normal. That's called fibrocystic changes. But you can see the calcification is very hard to differentiate from the background parenchyma. But you can see there is coarse calcification here. So it is a carcinoma cases. So can mammography tell us whether the mass is solid, cystic or complex mass? Because it is very important whether the mass is cystic, solid or complex. No, mammography cannot tell us about the solid cystic complex mass. We can see that, yes, there is a benign lesion, probably benign lesion or suspicious lesion. Now you see, there are multiple rounded nodule here.
Sorry, Rupapa, we have to finish by 5 minutes. Five more minutes.
Okay. So we have, there is a large rounded lesion here and another lesion here. In ultrasound, we see the large round lesion here in the left breast was cyst, the small lesion was cyst, and the left breast lesion was a complex mass. But in ultrasound, we cannot differentiate it. So I skip the lymph node characterization because time will allow. So is it necessary to do a mammogram when it has so many limitations? You see the all those slides. Yes, mammography has major role because both in screening purposes and diagnostic purposes, in diagnosis we do sonomammogram. In screening purposes, the mammography is the modality of choice because our goal is to detect early lesion. You see here, there's a shuttle change here. Can you see cluster of microcalcification here? The ultrasound was normal. This microcalcification did biopsy and it was positive. So that's the beauty of mammogram. That's why we do mammogram in all cases and additionally ultrasonogram. But what is the recommended age for mammogram? Actually, mammogram is recommended age for diagnostic purposes, 35 years. But in our center, we did 4 years study. The age of highest incidence of breast carcinoma, it was 35 to 40 years. 35 to 40 years. But in different country, it has screening age from 40 to 50 years. Like 40 years, some country 50 years. But in our center, we see the highest age 35 to 50 years. That's why in our center, we did the screening mammogram from 30 years, mammogram as well as sonogram. Before 30 years, screening only by the ultrasonogram. For diagnosis, with diagnostic purpose, we do the ultrasonogram as well as mammogram simultaneously. So that's all. Thank you.